1934 began with a brand new comic strip. Flash Gordon debuted on January 7th, 1934, created by Alex Raymond, and became one of the first popular science fiction-oriented adventure comic strips. Shell Globe magazine, dated March 1934, began featuring characters from Bud Fisher, Mud and Jeff, and Fontaine Fox, Toonerville Folks, officially licensed to sell gas and oil for the company, starting with magazine issue volume 4, number 2. 52,000 8-foot standees were made for Fisher's Mud and Jeff, and Fox's powerful Katrinka and the Skipper for placement around 13,000 different Shell gas stations. There was also 250,000 miniature figures of the same characters made. In addition, more than 1 million play masks were given away to children, along with more than 285,000 window stickers. Thousands of 3x5 foot posters featuring the characters were released in conjunction with 24 sheet outdoor billboards. Radio announcements of this promotion began running on April 7th of 1934. Giveaway comics had proven so successful that MC Gaines at this time believed that youngsters would buy comic books for 10 cents, just like the Big Little books that were coming out now at that time and growing in popularity. So early in 1934, Eastern Color ran off 35,000 copies of Famous Funnies Series 1, Number 1, 64 pages of reprints for Dell Publishing Company, to be sold for 10 cents in chain stores. It sold out quickly that Eastern Color issued a new version of Famous Funnies No. 1 in May 1934 with a cover date of July 1934. And starting in July with issue number 2, this became the first monthly comic book magazine. Famous Funnies was the first full-color comic book sold to the public. It set the standard of 68 pages, including covers, so selling for 10 cents. Early issues of this series, starting with number 1, advertised the contents as 100 comics and games, puzzles, magic. The series would come out with a new issue every month, making it the first monthly newsstand comic publication in America. The title continued for over 20 years through 218 issues, reaching a circulation peak of over 40,000 copies a month. In May that year, Famous Funnies was relaunched. It featured 4 pages, each of several newspaper comic characters, 64 pages long, but kept the 10-cent price tag. It had a 90% sell-through rate, but still lost over $4,000 to the publishers. A second issue that came out in July with a cover date of September was monthly after that. With the second issue, the magazine hired people at $5 a page to create original material for them. Meanwhile, it was costing the magazine $10 a page for syndicated reprints. The comic was edited by Stephen O. Douglas, but Moore got the credit in the first issue. From number 3 on, Buck Rogers took the center stage and became the comic's feature character. By the 7th issue, finally a profit emerged as the group made $2,600 in profit. But it must have been too little, too late, as Dell Publishing got cold feet and sold their 50% share to Eastern Color. Still, every issue had higher sales, and by a year's time, sales were up to almost 1 million per month. How the 10 cents per issue got divided among the parties bounced around as the series progressed. At first, Eastern would see 6 of the 10 cents. Later, it was up to 6.5 cents. The rest was split between newsstand and distributor, with the newsstand taking 2 and then 2.5 cents, and American News took 1 and then 1.5 cents. Eastern proudly made public the amount of money they were making off the comics as a way of saying, "I told you so," to the many people who rejected the idea at first. They were making $30,000 profit per issue. They also did this to drum up more business, either as a publisher or printer. By the time a year had gone by, Famous Funnies had gained some respect and was placed on newsstands besides slick magazines such as Atlantic Monthly and Harper's. They also had 5 competitors putting out monthly magazines. The comic series would last 218 issues, ending in 1955. At the same time, MC Gaines went to the sponsors of Percy Crosby's Skippy, which was on the radio, and convinced them to put out a Skippy comic book, advertise it on the air, and give away a free copy to anyone who bought a tube of Philips toothpaste. Thus, 500,000 copies of Skippy's own book of comics was printed and distributed through drugstores across the United States. This was the historic first four-color comic book of reprints devoted to a single character. On July 26, 1934, Winsor McCay, the creator of Little Nemo, one of the pioneers of comic books, died at the age of 64. Later in the year, Terry and the Pirates began its comic strip, publishing daily as of October 22, 1934, created by Milton Caniff, and featuring the popular strip and the adventures of Terry Lee in the Far East. Mickey Mouse Magazine came out monthly, put out by Disney, and there were two volumes. And in 1934, we saw issues number 3 through number 12, and then a relaunch for volume 2, number 1 and 2, come out in a format that was saddle-stitched on newsprint in an ongoing giveaway magazine, dimensions 5 1/4 wide by 7 1/4 tall, in two colors. Mickey Mouse was also published by David McKay in the number 4 issue, the final issue of the 4-year running series, in the square box 10x10 shape size that was so popular at that time. Though it was starting to go out of style in 1934, it was the very last big year for this large book square size. David McKay also released a new series called Secret Agent X9 in square-bound hardcover format featuring newspaper reprints. And later in the year, a second issue came out with a cover price of 25 cents for Secret Agent X9 number 2. The biggest publisher of books relating to comic strips was still Cupples and Leon, but this was their big last year as they decided after 1934 to get out of the business that they had been busy and successful in since 1907. In 1934, they published 8 of their last books, including Bringing Up Father, Dick Tracy and Dick Tracy Jr. and How They Captured Stooge, and How Dick Tracy and Dick Tracy Jr. Caught the Racketeers. This was a number 2 issue in black and white, dimension 7x8.5 inches, a soft cover reprinting 1933 strips. Cupples and Leon also gave us the final issue of Little Orphan Annie, which they'd been publishing since 1926. And Cupples and Leon gave us a special box set called Treasure Box of Famous Comics, and it featured 4 of their most popular titles. The dimensions were 6 3/4 by 8 1/2, soft cover format, and the books featured an earlier copyright date than 1934. And the box set, Treasure Box of Famous Comics, included Little Orphan Annie, Regular Fellers, Smitty, and The Adventures of Harold Teen. Tarzan was one of the most successful original characters of the past decade, and in comic book format we received Illustrated Tarzan book number 1, a second printing published by Grosset and Dunlap, with a 25 cent cover price, 76 pages, black and white, 9x7 dimensions, in a hardcover book format. The Gulf Oil Company continued to publish Gulf Funny Weekly. It would run from 1933 to 1941 with an amazing 422 issues in a tabloid large size and done on newsprint. So 52 new issues came out in 1934. H.L. Baker published a new series in 1934 called Comic Cuts. It ran for 9 issues, 24 pages. The dimensions were 9 3/4 by a hefty 13 inches. Newsprint format, it ran weekly from May 19th, 1934 to July 28th, 1934. McNaught Syndicate published Strange as It Seems, a free black and white comic saddle stitched, dimensions 5 7/8 by 8 7/8. Salfield Publishing Company gave us a Popeye cartoon book, a one-shot saddle-stitched, dimensions 8.5x13 with a color cover, 40 pages. Standard Oil continued to print their book series that they started in 1932. From 1932 to 1934, there would be 19 issues in a large tabloid size newsprint format. Western Publishing gave us the Famous Comics cartoon book series. There were 4 different books in this series, a set of 4 in total, printed with color covers, black and white interiors. The books were dimensions 8. Cupples and Leon ended their publishing empire as the top comic book related publisher, ending their long line of square shaped 10x10 books that they'd been publishing since 1907.